Welcome back, everyone. Day two of the World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid Bertelsmann annual policy dialogue continues with a conversation now on the new sustainability consensus. We spoke yesterday about the potential for turning the pandemic and the resulting economic crisis into an opportunity for moving toward a new sustainable economic model. And earlier today, we noted that the notion of building back better encompasses renewal of both physical and also institutional structures. Clearly, multilateralism has a key role to play. Indeed, a profoundly multilateral approach was crucial to success in Paris 5 years ago. But where do things stand today? And what must be done to ensure that the world acts on the words it signed up to back then? Those are some of the questions that we want to address with two outstanding speakers. And ladies and gentlemen, let me just remind you that we are also very eager to hear your questions to our speakers. So please share them via the chat tool on this live stream, and I will then bring them into the discussion as it progresses. So it is now my great pleasure to welcome here with me in the studio, Dirk Messner. He is president of the German Environmental Agencies, which is also one of the cooperation partners of this year's policy dialogue. And it's great that you join us live and in person in this unusual time that we're in.
Thank you, Melinda.
And it's also a pleasure to welcome Teresa Ribera. She is the fourth vice president of the government of Spain, and she's also minister for ecological transition and demographic challenge, who also serves as an advisor to the World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid. So great to have you with us as well, dear Teresa Ribera. And let me start now by asking you to describe both of your country's respective journeys over the past 6 months in terms of responding to the fast-moving coronavirus and also the slower-moving but equally devastating climate crisis at the same time. And I'll start with Teresa Ribera, if I may.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to join this conversation with this very inspirational title, the New Sustainability Consensus. I think that this is a good way to try to shape and express what we want to achieve. I think that we all have experienced how vulnerable we are, even if vulnerability is not exactly the same for every single person, but how vulnerable we are everywhere in the world and in a very simultaneous manner. And I think that this has meant a great shock for all our minds and the way we face what we need to do. I think that we all try to come back to the most important and primary things and discover that there are risks we don't want to be in a position to be materialized in front of us. This is why the climate and sustainability agendas have impacted so much in the public agenda everywhere, including in our countries. Not always with all the strength in the public debate as it should, but I think that it is part of a much more wider consensus everywhere. We have worked hard to propose the right and consistent answers. We are in a position to anticipate the type of challenges we need to face, the type of risk we don't want to face. This implies being much more consistent in the different policies we need to set and the type of signals and reforms we need to promote, facilitate a sustainable way out of this crisis. And I think that that's what we all have been trying to do, including in Spain. Since the very first moment, we paid much attention to the social dimension of the crisis. The previous experiences had been so hard. The increase of the inequalities gap, the impact on women, the impact on labor, the apparently easy response to forget about environment when trying to recover had left some experiences that allow us to draw some conclusions, some lessons to avoid these mistakes into the future. So we were working on what? Energy, water, land, territories, and resources to provide consistent answers and to address the right policy signals to facilitate innovation, investment, and employment. And this explains why in the middle, in the worst month of the previous confinement in May, we sent to the Parliament the climate law, and we have been promoting a very a wide agenda on green infrastructures, on adaptation to climate impacts plans in the economy, in the ecosystems, in the infrastructures, how to address the energy reform, how to invest in a much more sustainable way to produce and consume, so the circular economy and both in the strategic and the different sectoral approaches, but also in terms of the legal framework, how to build and to think what type of capacities we may need to deliver to be sure that whatever type of resource we use, including mining resources, could be addressed in a sustainable manner, what type of skills we needed to strengthen in order to be able to relocate people that may be facing difficult situations in the labor market, and how to facilitate a big bet on education and innovation. And this is what we have tried to reflect since the very beginning in the measures that have come along with the way we tackle the worst moments of the crisis, but also in terms of how to shape the recovery for the time to come. So resilient infrastructures, including resilient and restoration of ecosystems, the urban agenda, the cohesion in social and territorial terms, paying attention to what we call just transition in those sectors that have been effectively affected by the crisis of the transitions, and trying to stress the central place for people, but within the limits, the environmental limits, as a main guide to orientate our targets, as a common vision, a common mission, or where we want to be in 10, 20 years' time. So paving the way to walk the talk and not just staying in the very big words with no concrete answer.
Thank you very much, Teresa Ribera. And let me take the same question straight on to Dirk Messner, and also the question whether Germany is walking the talk. The talk is there. We certainly heard it actually back in the very beginning of the corona crisis here in Germany, Petersberger declaration by some leading German companies asking the government to move ahead with clear guidelines on essentially sustainable recovery. We've also heard the chancellor make some pretty clear pronouncements. Mm-hmm. Do you think the government will deliver the action?
Mm-hmm. First of all, hi, Teresa, good to see you. Regarding the 4-week observation, when the crisis started in March, I feared that it would look similarly to 2008 and 2009, the financial crisis, because in this crisis 10 years ago, green issues, climate, sustainability, everything disappeared from the agenda. No? The first reaction was fear, actually. My second observation is then, if you look at the stimulus package of the German government to answer or to react to the social and economic impacts of the corona crisis, 30 to 40% of the stimulus package, 110 billion euros, is green. So it's climate, sustainability oriented infrastructure and digital modernization linked to sustainability. 30 to 40%. So I am the president of the German Environment Agency. I would have liked to see 70%, but 30 to 40% is not bad. No. Third observation. 2 days ago, I had a meeting with high-ranking trade union guys from the most important German companies. We had a straightforward discussion about the transformation towards zero carbon in 2050 and about sustainability transformations in the middle of the pandemic crisis. This is astonishing, actually. No? And my last observation here is it goes beyond the German sphere. We did a study at Uber looking at 130 stimulus package reports which have been published around the globe during the last 3-4 months. No? And I think we have got all of the most important ones. And the result is that you find very little reports now focusing on stimulus packages to react to the corona crisis, which do not have in its focus climate and sustainability investments. And this is astonishing. This is a mind shift which has been taking place. No? And as we know, cognitive heuristics drive decision making and drive also investment orientations. Something has been happening between 2008 and 2020. 2020 is different in this from this perspective, is different from 2008 and 2009.
I want to move on to the European Union dimension, but perhaps just a very brief follow-up question, first of all, to you, Teresa Ribera, because you mentioned, in a sense, the tensions between social sustainability, taking care that people have what they need in terms of social welfare, that they can get back to work, take care of their families, and on the other hand, environmental sustainability. We are now looking at a second and third wave of COVID that could be even worse than the first. And Spain was hit hard by the first. Do you think that this potential trade-off between social and environmental sustainability could become more difficult then going forward if, in fact, the second wave takes a very big social toll?
I think that it is not perceived as a tension, something that Dirk was commenting, and I fully agree. It's not just the reaction of policymakers or business community reacting to the crisis in a very different manner in 2010 and now. It is that the type of risk and perceptions, the emotions and the cultural values have evolved a lot. And I think that in this very disruptive and frightening crisis, people has experienced vulnerability and to a certain extent is turning their views to very primary values, health, environment, so the context where we live and how healthy it is, households, families, so something that connects very well with the environmental agenda and provides a good ground to express to what extent social references and inclusiveness do also connect with a good state of health in the environmental context and good policies oriented to recover the balance between environment, economy, and social references. So I don't have much fear on that. I do have fear, of course, as everybody, on how long and how deep the health crisis may stay still with us. Because at the end, what we see is that something that is so small has gone so fast and so wide that it has impacted everywhere. It's a great shake in terms of humility, but also in terms of vulnerability and fragility. I think that we see to what extent everything is interconnected. So health means economy, health means social impact, health means environmental challenges or environmental responses. And is a very good catalyzer. Have a positive, constructive, optimistic approach on how to recover. So I don't fear that. As I say, what I fear is our own capacity to keep this under control and to ensure long-lasting responses to cover everybody in our societies.
Thank you very much. So what I'm hearing from both of you is that there seems to be a real sustainability consensus. Yes. That's the title of our discussion, in terms of how to build back better in a way that helps the planet and the environment, as well as people, in the sense of social sustainability. Let me ask you how you see it at European Union level, because of course our conference is devoted to the question multilateralism that delivers. Yes. The EU itself has also ratcheted it up its CO2 emission goals for 2030. It has put out the next generation plan with some very significant plans for investment in green technologies. Mm. Dirk Messner, do you think that the EU will deliver? Will it walk the talk?
Yeah. I mean, what I observed is in April, we organized a meeting of all environment agencies across Europe, not only European Union, all of them, more than 40. And there was in April then, Teresa, there was something like a divide. No, we had two groups of countries. The first group saw a group of countries, economically strong, dynamic, low level of public debt. No, and the response to the question, how are you managing the agenda on sustainability and climate protection in your economies? The response from these countries was, it's easy actually, because the new consensus is there. We are trying to link the answers to the COVID crisis to sustainability transformations. Mm-hmm. And then we had other countries, higher public debt, higher unemployment rates at the beginning of the crisis already. And the feedback from those countries was that it is very difficult to maintain these kind of issues in the public agenda, on the public agenda, because people fear that they are losing their jobs. States do not have the money to invest, which is necessary to fight the social impacts of the corona crisis. So a very different situation, no? A divided region from my perspective. And the way out was European solidarity. Teresa, you have been working on that, no? If you would not have got the 750 billion package for Europe as a whole, no? With a strong emphasis on supporting all countries around Europe to invest now in sustainability options, we would not have got the climate ambitious discussion which we have now around the climate goal for Europe. No? At the beginning, it was a division, and only social orientation in the context of cooperation in Europe moved away outwards.
Nevertheless, perhaps the question to you, Teresa Ribera, since you have been involved in those negotiations, how do we take that second group of countries along, countries whose economies depend to some degree on the use of fossil fuels, countries who perhaps aren't in the happy position of a Germany with its low public debt? What can be done to bring them into this sustainability consensus? And do you think the EU has some work to do on that?
Thank you. Thank you for the question, Melinda. And before coming into the fossil fuel challenge, how to phase out fossil fuel in our economies, I would like to back what Dirk has said, because I think that there are very important references behind what he has already stated. The first of them is that we have learned that working together, things become a little bit easier. So solidarity is a very important part of the answer. And this is another good reason why we need to strengthen and to stay committed to multilateralism, not only to Europeism, which has been able to provide the right answers for the time being, even in very difficult circumstances. The second thing is that when we introduce in the equation, the reference, the time references, we also have different answers. And I think that this is part of the key issues when dealing with sustainability and this new consensus on sustainability. I think that it was fantastic to hear from Europe that we want to invest in the next generation of Europeans. I think that this is not only fair and needed, but also a very important emotional, and I think that emotions are a very key factor, not just rational, in order to succeed. Emotional element of communication, because it is true. We need to invest in our future, and we need to use also this this driver as a very important policy driver. And I think that this explains why we all have managed, including Spain, we also have been paper by this European Solidarity, how we can frame in a very responsible and an efficient manner these resources to invest in our future. Then we come into the fossil fuel. And I think that it is true that the bigger dependence, the bigger share that we still have in our countries, the most difficult the answer is, because again, of the emotional factors and the traditions, the good things that have been connected to fossil fuels. It is the origin of unionism. It is. It has also meant for a very long time solidarity. It has meant many things. So get rid of that with no clear answer on what next is always tricky. And I think that this is something we need to handle with care and respect, but also being firm. Because we all want to invest in our future. And in order to invest in our future, we need to define what the future is. And the future is free of fossil fuels. So if we have some common references, it is easier to open a candid and honest debate on how to come along with those that identify more difficulties. The other thing which I consider it is important is to ensure that everybody feels part of the responsible answer to this phase out of fossil fuels. So it's not just governments and institutions willing to make lives difficult for people, the other way around. But utilities, firms, business should also feel compelled by the challenge. What we tried to do in Spain was to show this and to ask the owners of coal thermal plants or coal mining activities, how they show themselves being part of the society, and what about this famous ESG when dealing with their own business responses, how they could contribute to the future of those neighborhoods where they had got so much profit along the decades. And I have to say that the answer was quite positive. So I think we all need to find what are the key tips to facilitate the own responsibility of each of us. And at the same time, it is also true that once the exercise is honest and everybody is committed to this common future, it may be important to find the best ways to come along with those that still may have difficulties to make this transformation. But both things are real and need to happen at the same time. The own assumption of responsibilities and conclusions, and the way we come along with others once the common future, the common vision is accepted and honestly perceived.
Thank you very much. Teresa Ribera just told us that we need to also ensure that European Union action is embedded in that larger multilateral framework. And of course, we have a sustainability consensus in place at the international level. It is the Paris Climate Agreement, yeah, together with the Sustainable Development Goals, mm-hmm, both of them signed up to 5 years ago now. So my question to you, Dirk, would be, are you seeing sufficient movement on Paris? We've seen the COP now postponed until next year. It will not be taking place in the next couple of months as originally planned. Does that slow things down at a moment in time that is absolutely critical, mm-hmm, if we want to get where, yeah, we need to go with, yeah, Paris?
I mean, the moment is critical. For me, the 2020s, this decade, is the time of decision making. If we don't get things right now, we will not be able to stay below 2 degrees global warming. This is for sure. No, so this is the decade in which we really need to make the changes needed. And then I'm optimistic, as I said, regarding the green mind shift. And I'm pessimistic regarding the social dimension and the international cooperation dimension. So let's start with the social dimension. If you look at how to bring together in developing countries, in poor countries, sustainability investments and climate investments with social cohesion, you needed international support for that. But the momentum currently in the pandemic crisis for development cooperation is very, very weak, in contrast to 2008 and 2009. So in 2008 and 2009, we have been worse regarding climate and green issues, but better regarding supporting the poorest in the world. No? So there we have a challenge. And the second challenge is that for sustainability transformations and climate protection at the end of the day, because it is about zero emissions in 2050 globally, we need everyone on board. So without international cooperation, it will not work. And we are in the middle of a multilateralism crisis. No? We have huge nationalistic waves in many, many countries. I call this counter-transformations. No?
I have a question about that, but I'm going to pose it to Teresa in just a minute. Yes. And I want to ask you one audience question on the first point that you made in regard to emerging and developing countries. And it is this: how can SDG implementation focus on transformation in the least developed countries? Mm-hmm. And can these countries fit into this new consensus on sustainability? So perhaps a few more words on that, if you would.
I mean, people in least developed countries, let's say the 20% of the poorest people on Earth, they all depend on ecosystems. No? So if we don't stabilize ecosystems, this is about food, it is about land, it is about water, it is about biodiversity and about global warming. No? If we don't get these basics right, the ecosystem basics right, we will not find any solution for the bottom 20% of the pyramid if we look to the global population. This is the answer. No?
Thank you. I have a question also coming in from the audience on populism, and I'm going to sort of combine it with a question of my own, Teresa Ribera. But here is the question on populism from the audience. Could you reflect on the issue of populism and its capacity to erode possibilities to tackle issues such as the environmental protection and climate change? And we're going to start with that, and then I'll come back with a follow-up question of my own.
I think that this is the main or one of the main reasons to come along with the equity reasons to put the people in the center of any solution we are going to promote. I think that not paying attention to the inclusiveness message is quite risky, even eroding the main pillars of our democratic systems. So the development of social policies and solidarity is key everywhere in any type of society. And as Dirk was saying, just to link to his comments on multilateralism and LDCs and so on, I think that in the what we could say the three dimensions of equity, so between countries, within its society, and between generations, the aspect on the aspects relating to equity between countries also matter. So populism is something we are suffering in our societies because of the lack of response to social needs when apparently everything was going well. But there were many people that felt increasingly excluded, not even with an opportunity to be part of the society, the established society, and apparently the institutions did not pay sufficient attention to respond to the challenges. So I think that this is something to be taken very, very seriously. The capacity to be helpful and useful, and the political consequences of not taking this seriously. And this also, as I said, applies when talking about the equity among our countries. I think that there are always countries that may have more difficulties to face whatever challenges they have in front of us, we have in front of us, including this health crisis. And it is a big mistake to forget about the solidarity between countries. So this stress on thinking on good development and cooperation on development is quite a relevant shout that I share and back from Dirk's initial comments on this point.
Let me now ask you a brief follow-up question about what it could mean for the sustainability consensus if we had a different administration in Washington after the 20th of January. This was a point that was discussed earlier on today with something that was almost close to an election prognosis by one of our speakers. I won't ask you to do the same, Teresa Ribera, but what would interest me is this, because of course the description that you just gave of those to whom populism appeals in many ways fits the supporters of Donald Trump. And as you know, Donald Trump's administration has drastically deregulated oil and gas and done its utmost, essentially, to take the country back to an earlier time. Now, there are some people who say that doesn't matter that much because U.S. states are moving ahead, whether it's California or even Texas with its wind power. On the other hand, there is that crucial impact on international relations and on perceptions. Would that make a difference if we had a different administration in Washington in terms of gaining more support for the sustainability consensus worldwide?
I think that there are many interesting aspects to be underlined on your question. The first of them, something connecting to populism. I think that, of course, who is going to live in the White House in the coming years is a decision for the American citizens. But it is true that something that explains why this option that apparently is not going to benefit to those that have felt excluded was the option of many people that felt excluded. And I think that it is connected to the lack of confidence to the traditional political messages. So still very important to have social policies and people suffer in our minds when taking decisions. That's my first comment, because Trump was not saying that he was going to solve every problem, or he was not taken seriously. He was not voted because he was taken seriously. He was voted because people did not believe on other options, which is a drama, a big drama. We need to avoid this, to be perceived as a general comment everywhere. That's my first comment. The second comment is that, of course, there may be a great difference. I think that all what we have seen along these years has been terrible in terms of participation in the answer to global challenges in the global governance context. It has been terrible in terms of how to invest in our futures. It has been terrible in many of these climate and transformational challenges that we need to face. And even if being difficult and being challenging, it's better to do it in common than just one by one. So I think that there could be differences in addressing these issues if this one or other, the final option being supported by the American society. What I do not share is the idea that it doesn't matter because there are many other players that are doing their share. I think that it matters because in this complicated transformation, we may facilitate if there are synergies that are being stressed and efforts that are being supported by ones and others, than if we have isolated bodies, isolated institutions fighting against the general context. So I think that the role that the American government could have played in the governance of a world where there is a big share of the societies that have been excluded for decades that come up saying, hey, we want to earn and to win our future, and we want our voices being heard. And this comes from Asia, this comes from Africa, this comes from Latin America. It could have been easier with a positive, constructive player in Washington than what it has been during these years. It's not that the Africans, the Asians, the Europeans, or the Latin Americans are going to depend on what happens in Washington, but things do tend to be easier when we all are reasonably aligned. That's my first comment. Internally, at the domestic context in the US, it's more or less the same. If the federal rules do help, if the federal rules, laws do help, things go easier and faster. It is clear that there is a business community willing to play the role, an investment financial community willing to play the role, and local and state key political and social leaders willing to play the role. And coal is not going to revive because of Trump's statements. But it is going to get rid of out of the system because it is anti-economic, among other things. So I think that things do happen, but do tend to be easier if we all go more or less aligned.
Thank you very much. Dirk, if you like, comment on that as well. But I'd like to pick up on a related point, which is science-based thinking and lack thereof, because of course populism feeds on the distortion of facts, or even the rejection of facts. So I have a question from the audience on that point, and it is this: how can we make sure that science and evidence-based approaches are prioritized in policy making? How can governments be accountable in this regard?
Okay. I would start with the US thing and then go to the science. So regarding Biden, the possible Biden administration, two perspectives on that. The first one is that from an optimistic perspective, this could create a new geo-economical context towards sustainability transformations. We have the European Union working hard on the European Green Deal, which is very, very good. What a shift, no? Only a year ago, it was so difficult to discuss with the old commission about sustainability issues. Now it's different, no? So then look at Biden, and hopefully he will come in, and he has an ambitious energy and climate plan too. So these two markets together will drive investment patterns in the global economy. It would lead to China also aligning to these kind of investment trends. So this could be a new geo-economic context. This would be huge. It could be a game changer. No? My second perspective is then, this is related to the populism issue, which Teresa reflected upon. I think that sustainability guys like Teresa and myself and our community, we need to answer two questions which people drove to vote for guys like Trump or other nationalists around the globe. He's not alone. No? And the two answers, or the two questions which we need to answer, is that many people ask themselves, where is my place in this society? Social cohesion eroding in many countries. No? If we don't, this is about inequalities, and Teresa talked about this. So this is the first question. The second question goes even deeper, because many people argue that we are losing control. Globalization, digitalization, huge shifts of acceleration of many, many trends. And then we as sustainability people are coming with our argument that we need deep transformation and accelerated transformation towards climate protection. So again, speeding up. Yeah. And people are tired to be speeded up. And we only can motivate people for deep change if we have any idea about attractive futures. People who vote for Trump and others, their perspective is that there is no way out. There is only a way back. The nation, authoritarianism, easy answers. So we need to, we as a sustainability community, need to answer these two basic questions. Then the science thing. I mean, this is, I think, related again to the COVID context, because now in the COVID context, the interaction between society, governments, and science is very dense. And we are learning to listen to each other and working with each others. And how could we learn from that for this decade? Because we discussed that this is the decade for decision making. So how to build the milestones and building blocks for the transitions needed in our countries, and then in the European context and internationally, in something like a new contract between science, political decision makers, and society. I think this is what we needed to move towards.
I know that Teresa Ribera also has done work on the role of science and fact-based thinking in sustainability. So maybe you want to comment on this as well. And something that occurred to me as I listened to Dirk is that there's also an element, isn't there, of educating citizens about how to think about science? Because certainly one of the issues in relation to COVID-19 has been, I'll hear people say, you know, this expert says this and this expert says that. And back in March, they said this, and now they're saying this. And for them, that discredits the statements that they're hearing from the scientists. In a way, they want a very clear answer that stays the same. So science education also seems to be part of the equation here, isn't it?
Yes, yes, of course. I think that science education and science and education and public awareness is very important. And differently from what it has been for a very long time, now science becomes complicated to be more simple and primary. So you cannot ask every single citizen to be a very sound expert on the different aspects of science we have been used to work for a very long time, working on silos. So there were very good scientists working on, I don't know, a heart medicine. It was very good. There were very good scientists working on any type of zoologist area. And now that the world has been so clearly in front of our eyes, interrelated, interdependent, the knowledge and the interconnections are so deep. We also need to think of these educational aspects that could allow any of us to understand the complex reality in a science-sound manner, but also in a position to take our own understanding on what it means and what it implies, and to avoid or to be less vulnerable, fragile in front of fake news or whatever stupid messages we hear from time to time, or even honest discussions that do not properly connect to the issue of concern we may express. And this is not so simple. We have been educated for decades in isolated silos of information and knowledge. And coming back to a much more Renaissanceist understanding of what we all have in front of us deserves some attention. So very skillful, maybe with some concrete areas of experience and knowledge, but with the broad capacity to understand in a holistic manner what we are witnessing in front of us.
Thank you. I want to devote the last part of this discussion to the question of transformation, including transformational leadership. But I'm going to begin with an audience question, and it's this, and I'll put this to you, Dirk, if I may. There is progress, yes, but is it transformational enough? Given the aspiration of the 2030 agenda, i.e. transforming our world, and the scientific advice of the Global Sustainable Development Report 2019 that proposes to kickstart six transformations that go beyond the current piecemeal approach. So that old debate, incrementalism or the big sweeping transformation. What would you answer to this questioner?
I mean, my first reaction is that we need transformative and deep change, because we have to halve global emissions every decade towards 2050. And halving during one decade the emissions, this is a challenge for any country. So transformative action is needed. Now, my second sentence then would be, this is what also Teresa already talked about, you need to balance this with linking transformation towards climate protection with not forgetting people and social cohesion. No? Because speeding up will only work, we will only get legitimacy for that if people are on board. No? So social investments are a precondition for making climate protection happen. This is my main answer here. Mm-hmm. And regarding the understanding of political elites about what we are discussing here, climate protection, sustainability challenges, the Earth system, I mean, the positive story is that, Teresa, we discussed this many times. Now, the positive story is that we as scientists, we have been heading to research organizations and cooperating in this context, no? we contributed to make decision makers understand a very abstract problem, the climate crisis, you know, which is still not really there, because the climate crisis with its tipping point dimensions, this will start in 2 decades, in 3 decades. Yeah. No? So making people aware that there is something which is huge in an abstract manner is difficult. No? And we have been successful in convincing political decision makers, and as we said, private sector decision makers, that we need to shift the whole investment pattern of our global economy. This is a huge success from my perspective. Mm-hmm. No? But decision makers very often still not have understood that this kind of transformative action, in the sense which we are debating here, is really needed, because it's not easy to manage that.
Then let me ask Teresa Ribera, and maybe Dirk will comment as afterward as well, what truly transformational leadership looks like within this sustainability consensus? Who can and who must be a first mover, a leader that really takes the rest of us forward? You're on mute, possibly, Teresa? Is your microphone muted?
I was making a joke saying that your question is beyond my science knowledge, but I will try to do some proxies when answering your question. My belief is that we all are needed, and this is very important. We need some examples of excellency, so some models and catalyzers. This is why it is important what happens in Washington or what happens in Beijing or what happens in a big corporate, or to what extent the CEO is involved in the transformation of the business strategy of its own company. But at the same time, a few examples of excellency are not going to transform the world. We need everybody moving. So we need to raise the bar of the average, and we need to be conscious and proud of our own capacity to move at the different scales. This is why it is so important that small countries, small corporates, small people, small mayors, or mayors of small cities, I may mean, not the other way around, sorry, feel proud of what they do and feel motivated to do more. Because I think that this is the type of catalyzers that good connect to people's mind and good allow all of us to move towards the right direction. So I honestly think that we need big examples of leadership, but this is not enough. We need to play a round role everywhere in order to accelerate the transformation. So connecting to Dirk's comments, I think that all the transformative engines may be accelerated once we start to move towards the right direction, and there is a critical mass moving in that sense. That could be my humble and I don't know if right answer to your difficult question.
Thank you very much. I'm going to pose that same difficult question to Dirk, and because we're starting to get toward the end of our discussion, we still have about 10 minutes, but we're very eager to have actionable recommendations in the policy dialogue, things that we can really point to and say, this is something we can move forward on. So let me ask you this, because I know you're in contact with many different leaders in different sectors. Do you see role models for this kind of transformational leadership? Mm-hmm. And who are they, or what are the crucial elements of that?
Yeah. So I like Teresa's answer. You cannot make a transformation against society. So a society at the end of the day, no, need to drive the transformation. You, in democratic countries, we need democratic legitimacy for it. No? Yeah. But on the other hand side, pioneers of change are very important to trigger processes. No? And pioneers of change, for me, have three characteristics. The first one is that they drive trends, they don't follow trends. No? So sustainability, climate protection, defining the agenda of tomorrow. No? The second thing is, in the context in which we are, we need to think disruptively. This is about imagination, I think, disruptively. No? because this is not the way we think. We think incrementally. Mm-hmm. We learn in most of the fields we work in, we learn incrementally. But now we need disruption. How we think? How can we think and learn to think disruptively? No? And the third element is something which I already mentioned, bringing disruption together with social cohesion and bringing people into the process and making them drivers of the process. This is the third element. No? Mm-hmm. So isolated pioneers don't work.
Do you have particular examples you would care to share with us?
If we would look back in 2030 to 2020, no? And emissions have gone down during the decade. So who could be, where could be drivers of this transformations, pioneers? I would say Greta would be one, Greta Thunberg, representing a whole generation. We have been writing so many papers, so many books, and she's formulating this in very simple sentences, and she's very convincing. No, so it is falling on fertile ground what she is saying. Yeah. So Greta is such a person, but there are also business leaders moving into completely different directions. Elon Musk, you might like him, you do not need to like him, but he is revolutionizing. Mobile sector. No? He is producing the change needed in the German car industry because he's building a factory in front of our nose, not in Berlin. I mean, so we will change now, and he's driving change. So this is he's a pioneer in this regard. Pope Francis, from a cultural perspective, no? Laudato Si, the earth and humans, rethinking that. And reaching out to people which scientists cannot reach very often. So, and Teresa, I mean, you have been a brilliant academic, and then you move towards the political sphere, and you are combining this, no? And you are one of the drivers in the European field to make the European Green Deal happen, which could be a game changer. So, Teresa is a pioneer. No?
Very good. Ask Teresa also for your thoughts on role models, first movers, whatever you want to term it, but who can really drive this forward in the leadership way? So do you have specific names that you would put out there, or is there some recipe list that you would say this is absolutely crucial?
In fact, no, I prefer no. And I think that Dirk, apart from the last one, has made some very good references to names of people that are driving change. But what I think it is very, very important is to get rid of fear. I think that if we need to think in a disruptive manner, and at the same time walk the talk, because this is a race against time, it is very important to allow people to go for more in innovative ways, in innovative manner, and social innovation is very important. But at the same time, it is true that in terms of the critical mass we need, there are some that should feel in with a bigger burden in terms of responsibility. And of course, this happens to those that are part of governments. This happens to Europe. I think that Europe cannot miss this race. It should be a driver of disruption with inclusiveness and solidarity. And I think that in general terms, even with all the difficulties, when stating the signals and the rules through the institutions, we have more power than when trying to do at the very small scale, being a citizen. Citizens can be heroes. Small business communities can be heroes. Small countries can be heroes. But we should be asking more for those that have things easier. And I think that this is a question of responsibility. I think we need to challenge Europe in a positive sense, and we need to challenge the business community and the investors community, because the power to move things faster is much bigger than when we talk to scientists or when we talk to small business communities or when we talk to an average citizen or a teenager. So a teenager can be a hero, can explain things in a very simple and effective manner, but we should not be waiting for all teenagers in the world to change what we are doing. I think that that we need to be demanding to those who have the capacity to change to really engage at the level of what it is their responsibility.
Then let me ask both of you as my last question. Our topic in this conference as a whole is multilateralism that delivers. So let me ask you, because we do have lots of multipliers, people who have the responsibility, people who have the position that Teresa just described, who can really act in a way that can precipitate change. What would be your key message to these multipliers, whether they're from academia, business, policymaking, or civil society, about where multilateralism perhaps could do more, or what we need to change about multilateralism to enable it to deliver more? So I'll ask Dirk to go first, and then we'll close with Teresa.
Two very quick answers, because we are running out of time. Now, the first thing is governments needed to invest in multilateral organizations. We are weakening the whole system. A lot of the money which we are investing there is earmarked. No? So multilateralism only can work with strong and effective multilateral organization. Please invest in those. No? Mm-hmm. And the second thing is what we see is we have weak multilateral organizations currently, but many transnational networks driving internationally many interesting things forward, private sector driven, cities driven. This kind of unusual alliances are very important. So more of that and better aligning with it between those.
Thank you. Teresa Ribera?
Well, I think that in the same line, the main pieces of the main thoughts could be build alliance, be water, my friend. So use every single space in order to build and share positive experience, so to enable ourselves to go quicker. And I think that in the multilateral context, the risk of weakening because of every single small detail that may not be compatible with our short-term needs is quite a big risk. So I think that there are very interesting, innovative approaches to work in the multilateral context, sometimes because there are sectoral approaches. For instance, these days we are talking about the Antarctic and the need to increase the marine protected areas in the Antarctic. This is multilateralism too, and it is green, smart, modern diplomacy, and it is not always easy. And I think that in the big multilateral frameworks and in the sectoral or regional cooperation context, there are rooms for improvement everywhere. And we need to think beyond our short-term and local interests and try to build together, to find how we can build together. And I think it is very, very important that the machine does not stop. Sometimes there is the temptation to say, well, this doesn't go fast enough, so let's get rid of this. And I think that this is a big mistake. Let's invest do it work instead of complaining of the very long list of things that do not work.
Thank you very much. Those last remarks that you just made dovetailed with something that we heard earlier today from the former Australian Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, who said it is so important to make the gains from multilateralism visible to normal citizens who are asking, what does international cooperation ever do for us? And sustainability was, of course, one of the areas that he cited. So I think very much synergy with what you have just told us. Let me say thank you very much to Teresa Ribera for this very, very interesting discussion. Thank you so much to Dirk Messner for taking part and being here live in the studio for our talk about the sustainability consensus. And I wish both of you much success going forward. Thank you as well to everyone who's been following our discussion in the live stream. We greatly appreciate your questions and comments. We're now going to take a 30-minute break, and we will reconvene at 2:30 p.m. Central European time to hear a message from the United Nations Secretary General. So don't miss that. See you then, 30 minutes from now. Thank you.